Christ's presence. Thank you, God. We know that Christ is our true teacher, and so we tune in and hear from within what you have to tell us. And we do it. Amen.
Amen.
All right. This month of July, we're focusing on our Christ power of understanding. And that power is the ability to know truth, to have the experience, the direct experience of God. And that is a power that we have, every single human being, by whatever name we might call that divine presence, has the innate ability to know it and to experience it. And so our opportunity is to exercise that power. So let's align ourselves with our truth statement. And we will do it three times, as we usually do. And we know we make affirmations, not to make them true, but because they are true. Okay, so let's affirm this together. Here we go. I am one with the all-knowing mind of God. Divine understanding is awakened in me. Take it in. Let's align with it again. I am one with the all-knowing mind of God. Divine understanding is awakened in me. Let's think in. All right, let's align with it the third time. I am one with the all-knowing mind of God. Divine understanding is awakened in me. All right, so I hope you're having some spiritual awakenings this month. Are you? I am. It's a place of noticing God's presence. I am. It's pretty amazing. I'll tell you a little story this morning. I go out for a walk early, and I was walking out pretty early. Nobody else much was out. I passed by this gentleman. He said, "Have you seen an elderly white dog that looks kind of like a small lab?" He said, "I'm pet sitting, and the dog somehow pushed the gate open and has escaped." And I said, "No, but I'll look." So that bothers me. Animals are so vulnerable, and that kind of triggers me, you know, and I get all worried. And then I thought, hey, wait a minute. So I took a moment and put it in prayer. So then I've done my walk, I'm walking back, and I see the man, and guess who he's got on the leash? And I stopped and talked to him for a minute, and he says, yes. He said, the woman that was delivering newspapers saw it a few streets over, picked it up, and was driving around with it, I guess, and he saw her. She's looking for her own bit. So I'm not saying that I made that happen. But what I am saying is that it works. You know, when I calm down, when I get myself in that consciousness and make that direct experience of God and get off my worry and how I'm going to control it. There's a difference between taking action and trying to control everything. Then God has renewed, right? So God's at work. God's at work to those people. God's at work through that man who was so diligently combing his neighborhoods and through the woman who was delivering those papers, who took the time and had the kindness to stop and pick up that dog. So God's always present, and it's so wonderful when we notice that. All right, I got another story for you. There was a man who was very, very wealthy, and he had put in his will that when he passed, he wanted to be put in his best suit, with his best jewelry on, and set up behind the wheel of his favorite Cadillac, and buried in it, have a big hole dug and buried, whole thing buried. So when he passed, the executives of his will carried this out to the tee. So they did it, and there he was, dressed up with all his finery on, and he was set up there behind the wheel of that car, and they had a big hole dug, and they wheeled the car over there. They were getting ready to lower it into the hole. And there were some men standing there who were in charge of digging the hole and then filling it in. And there they saw him going down, you know, sitting there at the wheel of that car. And one of them turned to the other and they said, "Boy, some people sure know how to live, don't they?" It can be a little tricky sometimes to know, what does it really mean to live fully? What does it mean to live the good life? You know, in our unity teachings, we certainly don't advocate that people be impoverished, and I don't think anybody does. Nobody thinks that's really a good idea anymore. I think most of us have moved past that. And yet we also know, just as in our daily word reading was today, that I think we're starting to finally get past the idea in all faith paths that real prosperity or real abundance has to do with having a lot of stuff. You know, we've got a lot of stuff. And that our ability, what real abundance comes from is our ability to not focus on the outer things, but to focus on the inner life. As we know, Jesus said, seek ye first the kingdom of God. God knows you need something to eat. God knows you need something to wear. God knows you need a place to live. And as we focus on that wholeness of ourselves, as we focus on a congruent life, as we focus on spiritual values, what happens is that we do find ourselves fulfilled. And that we aren't putting the things that we have, or our status, or the number of zeros, you know, in behind the amount in our bank account, we're not making that God. We're not making it the center of our existence, but we're letting what happens for us in life be the fruits of our willingness and our ability to be whole, to embrace all the aspects of ourselves and to fulfill our talents. And so, it's not advocating that anyone live in poverty, but it's inviting us to let that abundance come from a different place. Let it come from a place of integrity. Let it come from a place of congruence. Let our insides match our outsides. And the other piece of that is that it doesn't just benefit us as individuals. That benefits everybody around us. It benefits the whole world when we start to understand that the divine self is an innate reality for every person, and when we start to honor that divine self, to live that way, and to find ways as a church community, to find ways as an Austin community, to find ways as a country, as a world, to embrace that reality and to see that that abundance comes through for everybody. It's amazing what happens when we adjust ourselves and live from that place of spirit, when we have that divine understanding of our true nature, how things begin to redistribute themselves. And instead of there being this strict haves and have-nots, it's amazing how from the place of spirit, from the place of harmony, from the place of self-respect and respect for others, life begins to adjust itself. It's amazing. And I can tell you that from my own personal experience, you know, from somebody that just thought, man, this is my life, it's never going to work, you know? And I was trying so hard to get it all in gear. And it began to shift for me when I started waking up spiritually. Mm-hmm. And when I started paying attention to the people around me that said, Anna, do you think maybe your problems have to do with the fact that you don't know who you are? And I'm like, no, it couldn't be that, I'm sure it's not. But they were right. They were right. And the more that I get it, that God is expressing through me, and that my job here is to be about Mother, Father, God's business, and that means to express my talents, to use the gifts that I've been given, to participate in life, and to trust God, and take steps, life gets better, and life gets different, and it becomes fulfilling. And amazingly enough, I have what I need. That's how it works. And that's what we're called to do. So, if we're going to do that, if we're going to live from this place of divine understanding, if we're going to live from that place of wholeness and well-being, you know that means we're going to have to take some risks, right? We're going to have to take some risks. We're going to have to let go of clinging to our things as the center and be-all and end-all of our existence. And we're going to have to put that in God's care and ask for guidance and direction. We're going to find more and more every day that we are living from that place of spiritual values, that place of spiritual integrity, and that place of spiritual wholeness. So that means we're going to have to step out and we're going to have to do some things differently. It means that we're going to have to let go of our biases. Not that, anything but that, right? To let go of our strongly held opinions about how it is and about what's right and what's wrong and about who God is and who people are and who I am and all that stuff. We're going to have to be willing to let all of that rigidity go so that we can let go to the experience of truth, of what's real, what's direct experience. And here I'm not saying that we shouldn't think, we must think. Of course, we got brains. And we're meant to think. That's what human beings are, as thinking beings. And where are we thinking from? Where am I getting my information? You know? Am I getting it from the realm of spirit? Or am I getting it from all the biases and everything that I'm just going to see out there? We need to pay attention to what's going on, and certainly we need facts, and we need to come from that place of knowing. There's a story you've probably heard many times, about the student who came to the great master teacher, and he said, "Master, I want to be enlightened." And the master said, "Okay, first let me invite you to tea." And so there they are, the master and the student, sitting there, getting ready to engage in the sacred tea ceremony. So the two cups are there, the water pot is there and filled with boiling water. And the teacher picks up the teapot and he begins to pour into the student's cup. And he pours in the cup is full. And then he keeps pouring, and he keeps pouring, and he keeps pouring. And the water spills over the cup, and it spills over the table, and it runs off the table, and it spills onto the floor. And the student was horrified. This is a great teacher, and he's so embarrassed. The student is thinking, "I'm not going to say anything. I'm so embarrassed. He's made such a boo-boo here. I'm not going to say anything." Finally, he couldn't contain himself, and he said, "Master," he says, "the cup is full, and the water's running all over the table and all over the floor." He said, I don't mean disrespect, but..." And the master says, "Ah, yes, that's the first learning. When the cup is full, it can't receive any." Now you're ready to begin. That's what Spirit tells to us when we're so full of our biases, so full of how we have the world all sliced up and how our place in it and everybody else, we can't be very receptive to the power of Spirit. We're too full. Now, I want to say something here, too, that's important. It's not about being receptive to somebody else's biases. Sometimes that's taught that way, and that's unfortunate because that is destructive. So it's not saying, "Okay, get rid of your ideas so now I can play you with mine." Mm-mm. It's let go of your biases so you can tune into that place in you that is unbiased, that place in you that has that direct knowing, that direct experience of the amazing, abundant presence that is God. The Sufi poet of the 14th century, Hafiz, said it this way, and I love this. He wrote, "Pulling out the chair beneath your mind and watching you fall upon God." There's nothing else for Hafiz to do that's any fun in this world. So when we let go of these ideas and pull out that rigidity, what happens is we get the opportunity to fall into God. It's a little bit like trapeze artists. You know, when you see people that are accomplished trapeze artists that are truly professional, it looks so easy, doesn't it, when they swing and one of them lets go and the other guy catches them and it's all good. I had the opportunity once to take a vacation at a resort where they had a part of what the activities were like a circus fun thing that you could do. Trust me, I did not participate in that. I tried rollerblading, which was quite an adventure, but anyway. But at the end of the time there, you could go and watch the people that had taken the circus opportunity. You could watch them perform. And so it was interesting watching people that had been doing this just for a few days. And I tell you, they had guts. They had a safety net. But to watch them do that and how difficult it was to watch the professional guy who was going to catch them. But to watch them, and they, you know, kind of they had to go through a few times and they fall and they try it again. But they had the guts to do it. But it was fascinating watching that process and like, yeah, you know what? It does take some skill. It takes a lot of skill. And it takes a lot of courage to swing out there and let go and trust that you're going to make that connection with that guy on the other trapeze and that he's, you can trust him that he's going to catch you and that he's got the strength to catch you. It takes guts. It really does. And that's an experience when we are letting go of those rigid ideas and letting ourselves fall into God. Do I trust? Do I have the courage? Yes, we all do. And it takes some skill and it takes some practice. But we all know that it's worth it because when we do that, we find that we're living in a whole different place. We're living in a different realm. We're living in the realm of spirit. And we know that we're spiritual beings living in a spiritual universe governed by spiritual law. And when we do that, life gets better. I want to share with you the an idea, too, about that we must continually enlarge our spiritual life, no matter where we are on our spiritual journey, no matter how long or how short a time we have been consciously interested in waking up and into our spirituality, or always called to do is to enlarge our spiritual life. If we ever get to the point where we say, oh, I'm good, I'm done now, I'm going to sit on the rock, I'm good, I'm going to tell the rest of you what to do, okay? That does not work, because we will become stunted just like that, and we will have acquired another set of biases. So we're always called upon to enlarge our spiritual life in all ways, at all times, to keep going. Don't stop. Don't pull up a rock and have a seat. You can rest. You know, that's part of the spiritual life. I want to share with you a little bit about Daniel. And this is from the book of Daniel, which is in the Hebrew Bible. It's a wonderful book. It's a very mystical book. It's very fascinating. It's got a lot in it. It's interesting imagery. Daniel was a young man who was part of a group of other young men who had been, the city of Jerusalem had been captured by the king of Babylon, Nebuchadnezzar, and he did what was often the custom of that day. He went into this conquered country, the conquered city, and he found the young men that he thought would benefit his kingdom, and men who had the capacity to learn and were healthy young men, and so he brought them over to Babylon so that he could train them to be officials in his kingdom to help him out, to be administrators and so forth. So the king wanted to do the very best by these young men because he wanted them, you know, to like him, to work for him, and to be in top shape. So he had rich food prepared for them, and he had them eating this rich food and because he wanted to do the very best for him. But there was one young man, Daniel, who said, I don't want to do that. This is going to make me sick. I don't want to eat all this stuff. And in the King James Version, it calls it the king's dainties. He said he did not eat the king's dainties because he thought it would make him sick. So he convinced the man who was the head steward to let him do a test so that he could just eat what he would like to eat, which was vegetables and water. And he said, that will keep me healthy. And so the steward agreed to this test, but he said, look, if you start getting sick and you're not healthy and these other guys are healthy and they're eating all this rich food, then the king's going to have my head. So you better, this better be right, you know. And he said, if it's not working, we're going to change things. So Daniel was a young man who had a lot of integrity. And because of that, he was able to tune into cosmic consciousness. He was able to tune in to that divine mind. He was able to know his true identity. And from that, he was able to be useful. So Daniel did four things that were important. One is that he kept himself pure, and that's symbolized by what he chose to eat, which meant that he, metaphysically, when we understand that, that purity means that he was not attached to putting things in the outer in front of him, that he was willing to stay clear. Another thing that Daniel did was that he refused to worship idols, and he refused to worship the king, and he served actually under three kings. And when the third king, King Darius, when he refused to worship King Darius, you know what happened to him? You've heard that story, right? That's right, yeah, thrown in the lion's den. And in the story of Daniel, the King Darius ran in there in the morning to see what had happened to Daniel, and Daniel was fine because God had closed the mouths of the lions. So Daniel refused to worship idols. Daniel continued to be clear that what he was about was worshiping the God of Israel, the God that he knew, that he had that covenantal relationship with as part of his community. And he was also committed to telling the truth no matter what. Because Daniel was connected to divine mind, all three of the kings had asked him to explain their dreams to them. And he didn't mince any words. If it was bad news, he just said it. You know, and that was dangerous back then. Sometimes the bad news bearer lost their heads. But Daniel didn't. So he did those four things, and that kept him tuned in to universal mind, and we can learn from that when we understand that metaphysically, is to keep ourselves clear of distractions, of all that would tug us. And again, we pay attention to the world, but getting lost in it. Stay clear of that. Make sure that we are willing to tell the truth no matter what. And that means staying in integrity with ourselves and maybe tuning in and learning what truth is, to learn to hear, to understand ourselves, and to stay congruent. It means that he was always going to put his relationship with Spirit first, that he valued that relationship with God, and that he was going to stay true to that, and that he was not going to worship any idols. And again, for us, that means putting something material in the center of our lives. And so because of that, Daniel had the ability to stay in contact with God. And I like to think about that as how? Honest, open, and willing. I didn't make that up. That's in the book Alcoholics Anonymous. You don't have to be alcoholic to benefit from that book. It is one of the finest books about spiritual development that I have ever read. So you don't have to have the disease of alcoholism, but I invite you to take a look at that book. It's incredible, the spiritual wisdom that's in there. So that's in there, that honest, open, and willing. How? That's how it works. That is how we continue to grow spiritually. And so that's what happened for Daniel. Let me share these few passages with you. This is when Daniel was serving King Darius, the third king, and Daniel was concerned about what was going on in the world. He was concerned about his own community, and he was concerned about what was happening and what he could do. He was concerned about all the conflicts around him. Is that ringing any bells? Anybody get concerned about the conflicts in our world? So here's what Daniel did. He basically had a vision. He was standing on the banks of the Tigris, and he had an incredible vision. And it was of this man clothed in linen with a belt of gold around his waist, and a shining man. And he had this incredible vision. And nobody else saw it. Other people were with him, and nobody else saw it. But they felt the vibrations, and everybody else got out of there. They took off. They felt the vibrations, but Daniel stayed. And when he did, he was started communicating with this person in the vision. This is what happened. And Daniel says, "But then a hand touched me and roused me to my hands and knees, because Daniel had fallen down on the ground with his face to the ground. And the man said to me, 'Daniel, greatly beloved, pay attention to the words that I'm going to speak to you. Stand on your feet, for I have now been sent to you.' So while he was speaking this word to me, I stood up, trembling. And the man said to me, 'Don't fear, Daniel, for from the first day that you set your mind to gain understanding and to humble yourself before God, your words have been heard, and I have come because of your words.'" That's a powerful statement. But what that's saying, you know, to us as we understand that, applying it to ourselves, is that whatever it is in life that troubles us, maybe it's our personal situations, maybe it's situations in the world, as Daniel did, we have to realize that just coming from our human nature, we don't have the solutions. And we're going to get really stressed out. So that's the first thing. That's the honesty and the humility of the how. Of my human self, I can't fix this. I'm willing to think there's something different. The openness. Daniel was open in those ways. He talked about those four ways. He kept himself open to God. Prayer and meditation is so important on a daily basis. And we all have different ways of doing it. But it's real important to do that, to cultivate that relationship and willingness. And as we read that passage on, if you want to read it at home, it's in Daniel 10. And as you keep reading it, Daniel says a few times that what? He says it before and after the vision. He says, "I didn't have any strength. All my strength was gone. Didn't have any strength." And every time he said that, some other loving entities from God would appear, and they would touch him. Some spiritual ideas, some spiritual experiences, and he would say, "Oh, I'm strengthened. I'm strengthened now." Do you ever feel like you don't have the strength to do what you're supposed to do? Sure, we all feel that. And so when we let ourselves be touched by that spirituality, by those spiritual entities, what happens to us is we are strengthened. And then we do what Daniel did, is we step out and we take action. We do what's ours to do. Charles Fillmore, our Unity co-founder, said, I think he was 92 or 93, "I fairly sizzle with zeal and enthusiasm as I spring forth with a mighty faith to do that which is to be done by me." Charles Fillmore could do that at 93 because he was honest, he was open, and he was willing, and he could spring forth. That's the invitation that we have. That's the gift of our power of spiritual understanding, is to stay tuned in. That's how it works, to open up to that presence of God so that we may have lives ourselves that are fulfilling, and that we may spring forth with that mighty zeal to be a blessing in the world. Let's pray. Sweet Spirit, today we're so grateful for our power of understanding, so grateful that we have the ability to know who we are. And so today we cultivate that in a deeper way. We ask for your divine assistance to open ourselves in new and deeper and broader ways to the reality of our spiritual lives. We bless ourselves, we bless our world, and we see good coming forth. Thank you, God, in the name and through the power of the living Christ. Amen. Amen.
Some say love is a river that drowns the tender breeze. Some say love is a razor that leaves your soul to bleed. Some say love.